In this example, I want to consider a given state of strain, which is 100 normal strain in the x direction, so let's say microstrain, and 50 microstrain shear in the xy frame. And let's go ahead and try and determine what the maximum engineering shear strain is at this point, and determine the two principal strains, the principal angle, and the maximum shear angle. And these are the principal and maximum shear angle for the state of strain now, not stress. So you'll also notice that this strain tensor that I've given here is the same one that we had in the previous example. And so I'm going to go ahead and start with the Mohr circle that we developed before, and I can immediately identify what the principal strains are, epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. Those are just the intercepts of the Mohr circle strain this time with respect to the horizontal axis. And so I can read off these values from the geometry quite easily, since I know what the radius of the circle is, 50 times root 2. So I can just add that and subtract that to the center value of the circle of 50, and that then gives me what the principal strains are in my system. So the first principal strain then is 1 plus root 2 times 50, and the second principal strain is 1 minus root 2 times 50. So that's pretty straightforward using the Mohr circle. It's just like using the Mohr circle of stresses. There's nothing different here. You just have to remember to use the tensorial shear strain when you draw these figures. The principal angle is the angle of rotation from the known state of stress to the horizontal axis. And so, again, I can read that off from the picture. So twice that principal angle is 45 degrees. And that then allows me to say that the principal angle is 22.5 degrees. If I want, I can also determine the maximum shear strain in the system simply by noting that the maximum shear strain, which happens down here at the bottom of the circle, is equal to the radius of the circle, so that gives me 50 root 2 microstrain. And if I want the engineering maximum shear strain, I need to multiply by that by 2, and so that gives me 100 times root 2 microstrain. The angle, I can also read off from this diagram, that's just simply this distance right here, or angle right there, divided by 2. So that gives me minus pi over 8 for the maximum shear angle. So this is one way of solving the problem. The other way that we can do this is not to use as the Mohr circle of strain, but rather to go after the eigenvalues of the problem. And so let me go ahead and just calculate the invariance. The trace of that strain tensor is 100 microstrain, and the second invariant, which is the determinant, is minus 2500. So the characteristic polynomial then is minus lambda squared plus 100 lambda minus a minus 2500, so that's plus 2500. And we can use the quadratic formula then to determine the two eigenvalues, which are the principal values, and so we end up with 50 times 1 minus and plus the square root of 2. And that's exactly the same result that we had before. To get the principal directions, I can go ahead and plug back into the eigenvalue equation. Remember, that's epsilon minus lambda identity times the eigenvector equals 0. So I plug in for the eigenvalues that I've just solved for here, and I now have an equation for the eigenvector components, and I can now use this to try and determine n1 and n2. So if I plug in the first principal value, I end up with minus 20.7 and minus 120.7, and I can go ahead and solve that, and I can determine what n1 and n2 have to be for this system here. Now remember, eigenvectors can be scaled, and we can also determine the angles of them. So if I just draw this in a diagram here, here I have x, here I have y, and I go ahead and plot my eigenvector here, n, so 1 unit in the x direction and 0.414 in the y direction. This angle in here is the angle of rotation that I'm interested in, and so I can just, from this diagram here, I see that that angle, which is the principal angle, is the arctangent of the vertical, the rise, over the run, which is just 1, which gives me 22.5 degrees, or pi over 8, which was the result that we had before. If I now want to determine the maximum shear strain and the maximum shear angle, what I can do is I can simply take the difference of the two principal strains and divide by 2, and that will give me the maximum tensorial shear strain, and that then gives me, as we can see again, 50 times root 2 microstrain. And if I multiply that by 2, I get the maximum engineering shear strain of 100 root 2 microstrain. The maximum shear angle I can determine from this simple formula here that relates the principal angle to the shear angle simply by subtracting off 45 degrees. And if I plug that in using the result I had from before, I find out that I end up with the maximum shear angle of minus pi over 8, which was the result that we had from before. So there are basically two ways to do these types of problems. You can use the graphical method, or you can use this more algebraic technique.